Hello, welcome to our Shikshana program on transmission and distribution. So in my last lecture, I discussed various types of insulators, and we will continue this lecture from there. So this is Professor Uma Rao from RV College of Engineering. Bringing you the lectures under the BTU e-Shikshana program for the course of transmission and distribution. So in today's talk, I will be focusing on the potential distribution in a string insulator and self-capacitance and mutual capacitance, and how to calculate the string efficiency. See, normally we saw, how do you form a suspension or a string insulator? You have different discs, right? So how many discs you use will depend on what is the voltage rating you need. If I use identical discs, then the capacitance of each unit will be the same because they're all identical. So you can call it as the self-capacitance or the mutual capacitance. It's called C. Okay, that is for each unit. Now if I have N discs connected between the conductor and the grounded tower, and if V is the voltage, then V by N is the voltage across each disc. Simple. So I have N discs stacked up one over the other. V is the total voltage. So V by N will be the voltage across each disc. But then every disc has a metal fitting. Okay. So there will be a capacitance between this metal fitting and the support tower, which is grounded. This is called as the shunt capacitance. Okay. We'll see how this looks. Let us assume the ratio of this shunt capacitance C1 to C is denoted by M. You can use any alphabet. Ratio is M. So my shunt capacitance is M times the self or mutual capacitance. Clear? Now, what is the problem with this shunt capacitance? It will create different voltages across each disc, even though all the discs are identical. We will see how. Look at this figure. So I have a grounded tower. I have the conductor here. So I have a number of discs. I have shown you three discs, which are connected through metal links, right? From the grounded tower through the disc, you have the metal link going. And you have the capacitance of each disc, that is C, and the capacitance between the metal fitting and the ground for each disc. So the circuit equivalent is as I have shown here in the second figure. So C, all the self-capacitances are denoted by C, and the shunt capacitances by C1. So this is between the metal fitting of the disc and the ground, that grounded tower. So I have from point P, from point Q, from point R. So I have the capacitances, C1. Clear? Shunt capacitance. Now let us, I have taken only three discs for simplicity. Whatever we discuss now, you can easily extend it to more number of discs. So let V1 be the voltage of the disc nearest to the cross arm, and V3 be the voltage of the disc nearest to the conductor. Clear? So with this notations, we will derive what is the relationship between V1, V2 and V3. And the total voltage V across the entire string will be V1, obviously V1 plus V2 plus V3. right? I am going to use only simple KCL, Kirchhoff's current law. What do I do? I apply this KCL at the junctions P and Q. So let us just see what it is. So at P, if you take the node P, the current entering is I2. These are all notations, that's all, I2. And I have a current I1 through C and a lowercase I1, what I have denoted as a lowercase I1 through C1. Okay. Now, what is this current through this self capacitance C? So the voltage across C and C1 is the same because this P is a common node point. So if you see this in the first disk, if you see, this C is connected between the ground and node P. C1 is also connected between node P and ground. So the voltage across both, the voltage across both is V1. Okay. And what is the current through a capacitor? The current through a capacitor is the voltage across the capacitor divided by the reactance. And what is the reactance of a capacitor? 1 by C omega. So the current will be the voltage into C omega, because I have to divide by the reactance, so it will get multiplied into C omega. So if you see the current through, if you see, take the voltage across C, it will be V1 into C omega, right? And voltage across C1 is also V1. So V1 will be equal to, so I have the current I1 here. So the current through this C1 will be V1 into C1 omega. V1 into C1 omega. And we already saw that C1 is M times C. C1 is M times C. Okay. So we'll just see what happens. See here, I2 is I1 plus I1, lowercase I1. So I2 is V2 into omega C. And I1 is V1 omega C. And the lowercase I1 is V1 into omega C1. And C1 is M times C. So I get one equation here. V2 into omega C is equal to V1 omega C plus V1 omega M C. So I can cancel out omega C in all the terms. I can cancel out omega C in all the terms and I get V2 is equal to V1 into 1 plus M. V2 is equal to V1 into 1 plus M. Clear? Now, I do the same exercise for the next node. Next node. So I have I3 equal to I2 plus I2. So this is across C and the lowercase I2 is across C1. So I am in the second disk. So the voltage across the second disk is V2. And the voltage across the third disk is V3. Therefore, I3 will be V3 omega C. V3 is the voltage across disk 3. So I3 will be V3 omega C. And I2 is V2 omega C. Right? And what is this lowercase I2? It is the current through C1. That is the shunt capacitance of disk 2. And if you see here, the shunt capacitance, I'll show you here. So across this second disk C1, the voltage is V1 plus V2. And across the third C1, it is V1 plus V2 plus V3. Clear? So if I want this current I2, it'll be C1 omega into V plus V1. Right? So that's what we have seen. So see here? Yeah. So this I2, which is the current through the shunt capacitance of the second disk, the voltage across that will be V1 plus V2 into omega C1. So I already know C1 is M times omega. See, so I substitute for that, and then I get V3. I can cancel out omega C in all the terms. So I get V3 is equal to MV1. Here I have MV1 plus V2 into 1 plus M. MV1 plus V2 into 1 plus M. This is one expression. And I already know V2. V2 is V1 plus V1 into 1 plus M. So I substitute for V2 here. And so I get V3 is equal to MV1 plus V1 into 1 plus M squared. Simple derivations. Nothing complicated at all here. I only applied KCL. That's all. So you see what are all the relationships I got? What are all the relationships I got? The voltage across the first disc is V1. That is the disc close to the cross arm of the tower is V1. V2, the next disc, is V1 into 1 plus M. V3 is MV1 plus V1 into 1 plus M squared, which I can further simplify. And I get V3 is equal to V1 into 1 plus 3M plus M squared. So are you observing what's happening? I start with V1. Then the next disc is V1 into 1 plus M. The disc after that is V1 into 1 plus 3M plus M squared. It goes on increasing. So as you move towards the conductor, as you move towards the conductor, the voltage across each disc keeps increasing. The voltage across each disc keeps increasing. So we will see what is this increase. We will see what is this increase slowly. So I have V1. I just consolidated here. That's all. Neatly I have consolidated whatever we derived in the previous slide. So V1 is the voltage across the first disc close to the cross arm. V2 is V1 into 1 plus M across the middle disc when you have three discs. And V3 is V1 into 1 plus 3M plus M square, the voltage across the disc close to the conductor. So if I have any, you know, I have some arbitrary number of discs, then I can write the expression Vn plus 1 starting from V1 is equal to Vn into 1 plus M plus V1, V2, etc. Vn minus 1 into M. Got it? Supposing you have five discs, let us say. So V5. So in that case, N will be 4. That is N plus 1 is 5. So V5 is equal to V4. V5 is equal to V4 into 1 plus M plus V1 plus V2 plus V3. N is 4, no? So N minus 1 is 3. So V1 plus V2 plus V3 into N. So supposing you have 7 discs, then V7 will be equal to V6 plus V1 plus V2 plus V3 plus V4 plus V5 into M. So you can easily write the expression for any number of discs. Normally, from an examination point of view, you may be asked to solve maximum for 3 or 4 discs, not more than that. And what is the transmission voltage? It is the sum. The transmission voltage is V1 plus V2 plus V3. Okay. So I get V1 into 3 plus 4M plus M squared. That's the transmission voltage. Now I can get the ratios of the different voltages. So V1 by 1 now is equal to, what is V2 by V1? V2 by V1 is, from this expression I can write. So V2 by 1 plus M is equal to V1. V3 by 1 plus 3M plus M squared is equal to V1. And if I take the total transmission voltage, I get V by 3 plus 4M plus M squared is equal to V1. So I get the expression for V1 in either in terms of V2 or V3 or the total voltage V. So these are the simple equations I need to solve for the voltages across the string. Now, what is the problem here? We will see. So when will all these voltages be equal? When will these voltages be equal? When will V2 be equal to V1? Only when M is zero. Similarly, V3 will be equal to V1 only when M is zero. M is zero means I don't have the shunt capacitance, which is not possible. The shunt capacitance is always there, right? So let us assume that M is 0.1. So the shunt capacitance won't be of the same order as the self capacitance. It will be around 10 to 15% normally, which means that M is around 0.1 to 0.15 generally. So let's assume M is equal to 0.1. Now, using this equation here, M is 0.1, M is 0.1. So substituting for M 0.1, I can get what is V1. So V1 works out to be 0.293 V. V is the total voltage. So I have the equations. I substitute for M. M is 0.1. So I get the total voltage. I get the total voltage. That is 26.3% for V1. In terms of V, V is a line voltage. That is V1 plus V2 plus V3. Similarly, I know V1 is equal to 1 plus M into, sorry, V2 is equal to 1 plus M into V1. So I know V1 is 0.293 V. So from that I get V2. So I recursively apply the formula. Vn plus 1 is equal to, we have whatever formula we have derived, this formula. You know, so I know V1, then I up from V2 onwards, I can apply this formula. V2 is equal to V1 into 1 plus M, so on. So here I get V2 is 0.3226 V. V is the total voltage. That is 32.26%. And V3 is 38.4%. What this means is, the total voltage V is not divided equally between the three disks. One third, one third, one third. No. Ideally, it should be V by 3, V by 3, V by 3 when I have three disks in series. But because of this capacitance, what happens? 26.3% only comes across the first disk, 32.23 across the second, 26 across the second, and 38.4 across the third. So, which insulator is most likely to fail? An insulator will fail when the voltage is high. The voltage across it is high. Right? We saw that. Every insulator is designed for a particular voltage. So if you see this disks, the insulator disk closest to the conductor, that is the bottommost, is most likely to get ruptured, because that is the disk which will have maximum voltage across it. So you see here with three disks and M.1, the third disk has 38.4% of the voltage instead of 33.3, which is one third, right? So the disk closest to the conductor is most vulnerable and most likely to get ruptured. So what are the things we have seen till now? Even though I have identical strains, the voltage across the disks is not equally distributed. Clear? And there is a ratio. That ratio depends on the ratio of the self capacitance to the shunt capacitance. That is C by C1, which we call as M. And the insulator closest to the cross arm has the lowest voltage, and the insulator closest to the conductor has the highest voltage. So the string efficiency is defined as voltage across the string divided by numerator, voltage across the string, entire string, all the disks put together, divided by n into voltage across the disk nearest to the conductor. Okay. So, if I take three disks with a value of m equal to 0.1, we saw that V3 is 0.384V or 38.4%. So, the string efficiency will be voltage across the string is V divided by n. N is number of insulators or number of disks, which is 3, into voltage across the disk nearest to the conductor, which is 0.384V. So I get 86.8%. This is definition. This is the definition of the string efficiency. Clear? If the voltage is equally distributed, string efficiency is 100. Because voltage across the string will be n into voltage across each of the disks, which are all identical. So it will be 100%. Right? So because of the shunt capacitance, the efficiency now reduces, and this is how we define it. So with three disks with a value of m equal to 0.1, I get a string efficiency of 86.8%. Clear? So now let us see one or two simple problems. How do I solve? What data I need? And what are the inferences? So a string has three units, just like the example I considered. And each unit has a capacitance C. The pin to earth capacitance is C by 10. Okay. So the pin to earth capacitance is nothing but your shunt capacitance. So it is C by 10. That is C1 is equal to C by 10, which means M is equal to 0.1. Because C1 is equal to MC, so M is equal to 0.1. Determine the values of voltage across each unit of the string and the string efficiency if line voltage is 33 kV. Now, first thing you should notice is, look at the string efficiency, right? This will depend only on the number of disks n and the value of m. Clear? Because the value of the voltage across the disk nearest to the conductor will be some percentage of the voltage across the string. So with three strings and m equal to 0.1, it is 38.4%. That doesn't tell you what is the value of the voltage. The voltage can be anything. The ratio will remain the same. The ratio will remain the same. So the string efficiency, please remember, is not dependent on the voltage level. The string efficiency is not dependent on the voltage level. It depends on the number of disks and the value of M. Number of disks and the value of M. Okay, fine. So the string efficiency, and if the line voltage is 33 kV. So with the discussion I have had, you should just close your eyes and tell me the string efficiency. I have three disks and value of M is 0.1. I have already derived the efficiency for that. That is 86 point something. So that efficiency will remain the same. Let us calculate and prove. So let V1 be the voltage of the topmost unit. V2 is equal to V1 into 1 plus M, that is 1.1 V1. And V3 is equal to V1 into 1 plus 3M plus M square, that is 1.31 into V1. Okay. Now what do I have? I have V is equal to 33 kV. Please remember, in a three-phase system, the voltage specified is always line to line. Whereas all your calculations are single phase, line to neutral you should. Okay. So if the line to line voltage is 33 kV, the line to neutral voltage is 33 kV divided by root 3. That is 19.05 kV. So this is the line to neutral voltage, V. That is V1 plus V2 plus V3. So I have the relationship. V is equal to V1 into 3 plus 4m plus m squared. We derived that. We derived the ratio V1 by 1 is equal to V2 by 1 plus m is equal to V3 by 1 plus 3m plus m squared is equal to V by 3 plus 4m plus m squared. Right? So I know V is 19.05. I know M is 0.1. So I calculate V1 and I get 5.586 kilovolts. And the string efficiency, V1 I have calculated. I need to calculate V2 is 1.1 times V1. And V3 is 7.317. So you see, the voltage across each disc is not same. And the lowest disc, that is the one closest to the conductor, has the highest voltage. It is 7.317 kilovolts. String efficiency is the total voltage, which is 19.05 divided by 3 into the third unit, that is the unit closest to the conductor, 7.31, 86.86. This is what we got earlier also, without any voltage level. So you see, this 86.86% doesn't depend on 33 kV. It doesn't depend on 33 kV. Okay? Because this formula, you know, V2 is 1.1 V1, V3 is 1.31 V1. That doesn't depend on the value of V. It depends only on the value of M. Right? So the ratio will remain the same provided your M and the value of M and the number of discs are the same. You do the same exercise for 66 kV. Okay, your V1, V2, V3 values will be different, but your efficiency will still be 86.86%, provided you solve it for a value of M equal to 0.1. Solve it for 220 kV, then also the efficiency will be 86.86%. So the efficiency does not depend on the voltage level. The string efficiency does not depend on the voltage. Next, let us find this. Simple. Find the string efficiency of a 37 kV string containing 20 insulators. The potential across the lowest disc is 2 kV. The potential across the lowest disc is 2 kV. Right? So the string efficiency is 37 kV. So the total voltage is 37 kV. And I have 20 insulators. So N is equal to 20. And the potential across the lowest disc is 2 kV. So 2. So I get 92.5%. Okay. Here I am assuming that 37 kV is the line to neutral voltage. 37 kV is the line to neutral voltage. Can you tell why I am taking it as a line to neutral voltage and not line to line voltage? You should use your common sense here. See, I have 20 insulators. Okay. So, and I have 2 kV across the lowest one. So, 20 into 2 is 40. Right? 40. But it won't be 40, it will be less than that. It will be slightly less than that because the voltage of each one above will go on slightly reducing. So 37 kV, if it is the line to line voltage, the line to neutral voltage will be 37 by root 3, for which I don't need 22 kV insulators. Clear? So I presume that this 37 kV is the line to neutral voltage. Next. An insulator string for a 66 kV line has 4 discs, M equal to 0.1. Find the voltage across the different discs and the string efficiency. So here M is 0.1, same as we did before. Only thing is, instead of 3 discs, I have 4 discs. Let us see what we do. So V2 is V1 into 1 plus M, that won't change. V3 is V1 into 1 plus 3M plus M squared. V4, I will use the old formula, general formula, Vn plus 1. So V4, n is 3, is equal to V3, Vn into 1 plus m plus V1 plus V2 into m. I get 1.651 V1. Clear? V2, V3 expressions are the same because m is 0.1. Now I have a fourth disk. So I evaluate the voltage of the fourth disk across the fourth disk using the general formula. Vn plus 1 is equal to Vn into V1 plus V2 up to Vn minus 1 into m. So it is equal to 1.651 V1. Now, let us solve. The transmission voltage is V1 plus V2 plus V3 plus V4. That is equal to 5.061 V1. V1 is the voltage across the first disc closest to the cross arm. Okay. Voltage V is equal to 66 by root 3. We have told 66 kV. That is 38.105 kV. V1, we have the ratios. 7.529 kV. V2 is 1 plus m into V1. I have the expression for V3 and I have the expression for V4. So you see the voltage across the discs progressively increases. 7.5, 8.2, 9.8, 12.4. So the more number of discs you have, the more the unbalance. The more number of discs you have, more the unbalance. And the disc closest to the conductor will get ruptured because it will have a high voltage across it as compared to the others. Now, what is the string efficiency? The total voltage V, that is 38.105. I am taking the line to neutral voltage. All these are line to neutral voltages. Four into 12.43. So I get 73.63%. So as the number of discs increases, the efficiency will come down for the same value of M. Because the voltage difference goes on increasing. Now let us take one more example. So I have a suspension insulator with 3 units. Each unit can withstand a maximum of 11 kV. The capacitance of each joint and metalwork is 20% of the capacitance of each disc. That means C1 is equal to 20% of C. Okay. Find the maximum line voltage for which the string can be used and what is the string efficiency. So here the problem is worded in a slightly different way. Each disc can withstand 11 kV. You are given the ratio of the two capacitances. So what is the maximum line voltage for which you can use this disc? And what is its efficiency? Clear? So we will see. Now, what is M? M is 0.2 because it is 20%. So it is 0.2. V2 is V1 into 1 plus M. We have already derived that. So M is 0.2 here. So V2 is 1.2 V1. And V3 is 1.64 V1. So I now know the ratios of the three voltages. The first disc, topmost disc is V1. Then V2 is 1.2 times V1. And V3 is 1.64 V1. Now my constraint is V1, V2, V3, all of them should be less than 11 kV. Clear? To find the maximum line voltage. Supposing I assume V1 is 11 kV, then V3 will be 1.64 times 11 kV. So V3, this disc cannot handle that. So since each disc voltage is restricted to 11 kV, it means that the maximum voltage across any disc is 11 kV. So which disc has the maximum voltage? I told you we are seeing it here, V3. V3 has the maximum voltage. It is 1.64 times V1. So I start with V3. V3 has the highest voltage. So let me assume that this cannot exceed 11 kV because that's the maximum it can withstand. So let us take V3 to be 11 kV. Here, V3 is 11 kV. The maximum voltage is 11 kV across it. So from that, I find out V1. V1 will be 11 divided by 1.64. And once I find V1, I find V2. So V1 is 6.707. V2 is 8.05, and maximum voltage of all the three together will be the sum 6.7 plus 8.04 plus 11, that is 25.747 kV. Now you see why I said you can't take V1. If you take V1 is 11 kV, V2 will be more than that, V3 will be much more than that. So this is the phase voltage, line to neutral voltage. So the maximum line to line voltage is root 3 times this, that is 44.6 kV. And what will be the string efficiency? String efficiency, the total voltage, that is 25.747 divided by N. N is 3 into voltage across the disc closest to the conductor, that is V3, 11 kV. So the string efficiency is 25.747 divided by 3 into 11 into 100, that is 78.02%. Okay, so let me summarize what we have seen in this class. So we saw how the voltage is distributed across a suspension insulator made of a number of discs. So even if we have identical discs, because of the capacitance between the metal pin link in each disc and the ground, which we call as the shunt capacitance, the voltage is not uniformly distributed. The voltage is not uniformly distributed. So there is a definite relationship between the voltages across each disc. This will depend purely on the value of M. It will depend on the value of M. Okay, so the disc closest to the cross arm will have the least voltage, and the disc closest to the conductor will have the maximum voltage. And the difference between the two will increase as we increase the number of discs. So the string efficiency is defined as the total voltage divided by the number of discs into the voltage across the disc closest to the conductor. And the string efficiency does not depend on the voltage levels. It depends on the number of discs and the value of M. That is the ratio of the self capacitance to the shunt capacitance. Clear? And the disc closest to the conductor is most prone for rupture because that has the maximum voltage across it. So in the next session, we will see how we can improve the string efficiency.